May I? F***ing Dutch.
I'm going to skip my visit to McDonald's this evening to retaliate.
Today we shall discuss the interview Jon Stewart had with Reza Aslan in The Daily Show on May the 13th of this year. This discussion is a follow-up to our discussion about the interview in the same show with Ayaan Hirsi Ali. And you might say that the interview itself is a follow-up. Just for the people who don't know Reza Aslan, he is a religions scholar who frequently appears in the media as an apologist for theism. And he is a believing theist himself.
You know, I've always said religion has given people great comfort in a world torn apart by religion.
I think that's a great line.
It's very true, I think. The comfort it brings makes up partly for the discomfort it brings.
Why hasn't God just settled this?
Yeah, he really should. Just who's right? Just get it over with.
Why? Because doesn't he ever think, okay, this has gone on long enough?
I think that's a very good question.
Yeah, yes. It's a very interesting question. It's a version of the ancient question attributed to Epicurus, among others, which reads, if God is all good and all powerful, both, why doesn't he stop evil? And that question is so dangerous for theism that it's very understandable that Reza Aslan does not go into that. He laughs, but he seems to follow up to it, but he goes on to proceed with something completely different.
Well, look, the thing about religion that people have to understand is that it's far more a matter of identity than it is just a matter of beliefs and practices. I mean, those things are important, but when you say I'm a Jew, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Christian, you're making an identity statement far more so than a statement of the things that you believe.
It is true that a lot of people who call themselves Christians do not believe in Jesus or his divinity, but just call themselves Christians in a cultural sense. But I don't think those people are really the people who criticize religion criticize primarily. I don't consider them to be true theists because they don't believe in the personal God that adjective Christian suggests, Christ. As I say this, I already imagine the response, well, who is this guy to determine for people what they can and cannot believe? Or what they can and cannot call themselves. I do not want to coerce them, either physically or legally, into saying something else. But intellectually, I think, is dishonest. If I were to call myself a Marxist, and I would say, I'm a Marxist, I believe in a market that should be rabidly free and merciless. I believe in a small, top-headed, monocled upper class who should subjugate and exploit the working class. I'm a Marxist. Now, I would hope someone would say to me that that's ridiculous. My definition of that word is so far removed from the term that it becomes meaningless.
Yes.
It gets stretched to the point of breaking. And the same should go for people who use these religious adjectives to describe themselves. There should be something there fundamental to warrant
the existence of the word,
the separate entry in the dictionary.
Religion is, more than anything else, a choice, but not viewed that way.
Again, I think this is very true. Religion is, or at least should be, I think, a choice, but it's not viewed that way by many people. Some of those people are not religious themselves, but consider the religion of others something that is inherent to their upbringing. So your parents are Muslim, so you will be Muslim. That's just natural, right? And there are also religious people who view it that way, which means they will force their children, and sometimes other people as well, to adopt their religion.
I wonder if the indigenous peoples of South America viewed their conversion back in the day by Spanish and other European powers to have been a choice. I don't think so. The entire Christianity of the Latin American continent is due to something very coercive and very criminal, not a choice at all. And secondly, if the theology were true, then it certainly wouldn't be a choice. Or at least it wouldn't be a very fair choice, because you could choose not to believe. But if you wouldn't believe, you'd be tortured forever. Or denied the grace and love of God after you die.
So there is force inside the theory, you might say. Coercion inside the theory.
That's not really a choice.
The people who criticize religion, and not race, mind you, just religion, the doctrine, they imply that it is a choice, that you can leave Islam if you agree with the criticism. So the people who criticize Islam agree with Jon Stewart on this point. It's a choice.
Yeah.
The people who think Islam can't be criticized think it's not a choice.
Yeah.
So you shouldn't criticize it, but because those people can't help it.
Yeah.
Part of the problem is that there's this misconception that people derive their values from their scriptures. And the truth is that it's more often the case that people insert their values into their scriptures. I mean, otherwise, every Christian who read the Bible would read it exactly the same way.
He calls this a misconception, but I think the fundamentalists do derive their values directly from their scriptures, or at least try to do so.
In this country, not 200 years ago, both slave owners and abolitionists not only used the same Bible to justify their viewpoints, they used the same verses to do so.
I would gladly take this to be true, though I think the slave owners had more verses to choose from than the abolitionists.
Yeah, and I'm also curious to see those verses.
I mean, that's a thing about Scripture, its power comes from its malleability. You can read it in any way you want to. If you are a violent misogynist, you will find plenty in the Quran or in the Bible to justify your viewpoint. If you're a peaceful feminist, you will find just as much in those scriptures to justify your viewpoint.
Well, this whole sentence is really just absurd relativism. Here he practically goes as far as to say it really doesn't matter if you read a manual for a freezer for in your kitchen or a holy book. That's what he says. He says you can read it in any way you want to. So if you read when the freezer starts beeping, that means the door is not properly closed. That might lead a violent misogynist to think, I might hit my wife right now. In exactly the same degree as the following surah from the Quran, surah 434. Men are in charge of women, because Allah hath made the one of them to excel the other, and because they spend of their property for the support of women. So good women are the obedient, guarding in secret what Allah hath guarded. As for those from whom ye fear rebellion, admonish them and banish them to beds apart, and scourge them. Scourging is punishing physically. Then, if they obey you, seek not a way against them. So those two are completely interchangeable. Freezer door is not properly closed. Hit your wife. And more importantly, a feminist might read that and say, well, there's feminism in that quote. If the wife obeys, then the husband has no right to act against it. So that's really a feminist. I mean, he can't...
Well, I'm sorry, I think it's really unfair. You quoted that completely out of context. You should see it in its context.
Yeah, it's a metaphor, of course.
It's a metaphor for
giving your wife Thai massages every night.
Right.
Listening to everything she has to say. The absurd statement that a feminist might find just as much in the Bible or the Quran as a misogynist, that's just complete bullshit. And a lot of women have died and were tortured and had to suffer because of those holy books. So that's an awful thing to say. Right. I don't think he can be serious. And on top of that, I wonder what exactly is the point of a holy book then?
If it's empty, really.
If it's empty. All that happens is the reader producing something and the text produces nothing. And Reza Aslan seems to completely ignore that holy books are not meant to be some casual companion which you can leave through if you're out of inspiration for something to project your own thoughts on. It is a holy book. And in the case of Islam, it's even the definitive, final revelation of the creator of everything that exists. That's the intention of the book.
Because the books are very contradictory, you could read them in more than one way, that's true, by cherry picking, by the way, but that still doesn't mean that you can read them in any way you like. There is a limit to the freedom of interpretation, which Jon Stewart is going to prove.
What if you're a Jew who loves a bacon egg sandwich?
I think what Jon Stewart says here is funny because he proves that there is a limit to this malleability.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot be a Jew and read your scripture in such a way that you can eat bacon. That's impossible.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So there is a limit.
I would recommend the Book of Mormon for you.
Reza Aslan admits this by recommending the Book of Mormon, a non-Jewish book. Reza Aslan has to switch to a different religion to be able to give Jon Stewart divine permission to eat bacon.
Mm-hmm.
He should stop being a Jew to eat bacon.
Yeah.
That's what Reza Aslan says, in fact.
Yeah.
Jokingly or not.
Yeah.
And then Jon Stewart says...
But that is the point!
Jon Stewart doesn't get his own joke. He thinks that with this joke he has proven Reza Aslan's point, but he has disproven his point with this joke. Jon Stewart seems to... intuitively get things right where he gets them wrong when he starts to think about them.
Exactly. The point is that without interpretation, scripture is just words on a page. It requires somebody to read it, to encounter it, for it to have any kind of meaning.
This goes even further with the relativism. When I write the word monkey, you might think of an orangutan, and a third person might think of a chimpanzee. But no one is thinking of a pink Cadillac. Everyone's thinking of a monkey. So there is a degree of interpretation, but as you said, it has a limit. And that's something that literate people understand. That's when I write something, then probably it will be read in a certain way, somewhat similar to the way I meant it, within this bandwidth of possible meanings. Those words on the page are already anticipating a certain interpretation.
Reza Aslan denies that a text can contain certain ideas and not contain other ideas.
Mm-hmm.
It contains everything and nothing at the same time.
Yeah, I'm sure he doesn't really believe that, but that's the point he keeps making, showing that he's almost running out of ways out.
God does not make you a bigot, you're just a bigot.
I think that's problematic in two ways. First, certain texts can certainly make you behave in certain ways. Not only religious texts do it, but take, for instance, secular law.
We use language constantly, all day, to influence people's behavior.
Yeah. The second problem with this is something that the Pakistani-Canadian writer Ali Rizvi pointed out. If it's not the religion that is to blame for the violence and the backwardness and the misogyny and the homophobia and all those things, then it must be the people.
Their race, maybe. Are they born bigots? Or are they made bigots by something else than the scripture? And if so, by what?
Not by language, obviously.
Not by anything that has to do with language, for then it could also be scripture. So it has to be something else. What is it? God doesn't make you a bigot. No, of course not. God doesn't do anything.
No, because he doesn't exist.
This might sound childish, but I mention it because often atheists are being accused of taking God too seriously. When you say, as an atheist, God is horrible, someone else might say, I thought you didn't believe in God.
Yeah.
People like to point out to atheists sometimes, like Jon Stewart is about to do, by the way,
mm-hmm.
that religions are human constructs. I don't think that God makes people bigots. I think people make people bigots by badly informing them.
Yeah.
For example, by calling medieval texts holy and the word of God.
Right.
Or even pre-medieval texts.
The violence, that is a good point.
Well, it's not a good point.
And the violence in that region is an outgrowth of a paucity of many things. Not religion, not being the sole driver of these identity difficulties that are going on.
Paucity is scarcity,
mm-hmm.
lack. Religion itself is, I think, an outgrowth of a paucity of many things. Most notably, education.
There's a lot of issues that are involved: social issues, political issues, cultural issues. All those things.
When you stick around,
I think everybody agrees with that. Atheists too, and all those issues, I think, would be so much easier to address without religious nonsense standing in the way all the time.
Yeah. If you want to tackle some problem, you can't because there are some feelings to be hurt.
Right, there's some dogma you have to respect.
These constructs that we create, if you remove religion, people forget we created that construct. Whether you believe it came from God or not, we're the ones who created the institutions around it.
This is the point I was alluding to earlier. Who are these people who forget? I haven't forgotten.
Yeah.
I'm very aware of it. Jon Stewart seems to think that he needs to tell atheists that religions are man-made.
What drives me absolutely bananas is this constant refrain you hear from some of your guests, in fact, that you know what Islam really needs? You know what Islam really needs? It needs a reformation.
I know the guest you're talking about.
I know exactly the guest you're talking about.
I was here that night.
You were there. And I remember. And my answer to that is, like, open your eyes, man. What do you think is going on? Do you think that Do you think people think that reformation is about, like, holding hands and singing Kumbaya?
Well, here they both make a subtle reference to the Ayaan Hirsi Ali interview. And I think it's a very sad way to treat her.
Hirsi Ali never said that reformation is about holding hands and singing Kumbaya.
Yeah, when did she say that?
No, she hasn't said that, but what's true is she is calling for a reformation. And that can easily be interpreted as a call for a violent change. And that keeps haunting her, that keeps dogging her around, that word.
Yeah.
Reza Aslan is happy to use it against her. I think knowingly ignoring her real intentions.
Yeah. I wouldn't put that past him.
It feels like we are in a cycle of violence in the Middle East that is akin to the Hundred Years' War. Bloody, long-term, not easily solvable. It will pitch back and forth. Seeing that coming is akin to watching a tornado coming to hit you, and you're somewhat powerless to stop it. And what we seem to have done is, oh, those guys look like it's a hornet's nest. What if we, I don't know, do you got a stick here? Why don't we just...
yeah.
I think that's a good point, well made, because here he acknowledges that the Middle East was a hornet's nest before 2003 or 1979 or whatever year, and also acknowledges that it was very stupid to, and even illegal, to poke the stick in the way that the American coalition... did.
I do think that we need to resist saying, you know, ISIS has nothing to do with Islam, or, you know, the violence in the name of religion has nothing to do with religion. Well, of course it has to do with religion. Mm-hmm. I mean, look, if ISIS calls itself Muslim, we should probably take them seriously. Mm-hmm. Fine, they are Muslim.
He can only say this after making the word Muslim not mean anything anymore. Because he also said, well, if you say I'm a Muslim, you're not necessarily ascribing to the teachings of Muhammad. It's an identity. He has already made it so vague that it's not a stretch for him to say, well, all right, ISIS is Muslim.
If that is their organizing principle, but I would suggest without that, they would find another organizing principle, whether it be through a tribal affiliation, whether it be through a nation state. We are very adept at finding organizational categories for ourselves to belong to.
Yeah.
To fight a group that belongs to a different one.
Even if that were so, it would still be useful to criticize those unnecessarily divisive principles and categories. And since we can't criticize them all at once, we have to criticize them one at a time. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we criticize tribal affiliations and nation states, patriotism, nationalism, sometimes religions.
He's criticized the Republican Party for 17 years, excavating a concrete narrative that they put forward. And I think he's sketched that narrative pretty well. What if someone would say to him, well, you've wasted all those years at The Daily Show. There's always going to be propaganda. There's always going to be corrupt politicians. There's always going to be immoral politicians. What kind of a defeatist stance is that?
People suck, live with it.
We should still try and inch forward, as I believe we have over the course of 100,000 years.
And religion is a very good category.
It's
in fact, it has the most currency for the masses.
It's the easiest way, I think.
Which is just a religion.
Now, note here how casually they both seem to say all of a sudden that religion is the easiest way. It's a wonderful way. It has the most currency for the masses. Masses to which Reza Aslan, of course, doesn't belong. And then Jon Stewart says, it's that and sports teams, I think. And then Reza Aslan replies, which is just a religion. No, it's not. Yeah. Again, the relativism.
Yes.
You might say sports is like a religion to some people. Metaphorically, you may link the two. But it's not just a religion. Sports is not a religion. And they certainly aren't theistic religions, which is the brand of religion that Reza and John are discussing here.
In America, we've defined our largest fear as Islamic terrorism.
Yeah.
And by defining that, because of the American character of whatever we're worried about is the worry.
Note the fact that it's apparently okay to paint Americans with one giant brush.
Yeah.
Our American character.
Actually, according to the FBI, you are more likely to die from faulty furniture than from terrorism. So, like,
now,
your
are you
lazy
saying,
boy is more dangerous than ISIS.
I think that depends on whether or not you're drawing Muhammad cartoons in that lazy boy. Some elements of Western culture are in danger. And elements I find important. People who make the most of their right to free speech, for example, are in danger.
Yeah.
And I think these people are more endangered by ISIS than by their furniture.
This fear is so manufactured by, you know, a news channel that has spun it into ratings gold, some other, we won't talk about, politicians who use it to get votes.
Well, I think this is completely true. The fear, which is justified, becomes phobia when it's blown up to irrational proportions. And channels like Fox News, to which Reza Aslan is alluding here, undoubtedly do that. And our great national treasure, Geert Wilders, also does that. But I would want to add that, to me, that is an inherent part, fundamental part of monotheistic religion, fear. Mm-hmm. When you behave like this, or are of this people, then you will, you're chosen.
You'll be rewarded.
Yeah, and if you don't or aren't, then you will be punished. Mm. So fear sells indeed, and I think that's why theism is so popular and 5 or 6 billion people adhere to it.
Everything that was said about Americans today, about Muslims today, was said about Jews in the 40s and 50s, was said about Catholics in the end of the 19th century. Mm. And those two religions, through the passage of time, through the slow building of relationships, through the integration of story, became very much a part of the religious fabric of this country. The same thing's going to happen to Muslims.
Will this happen without the impairment of freedom of speech, women's rights, gays' rights, the secular state, etc.? Or with the impairment of those things? That's crucial to me. Hysterical fear of Muslims is not the only thing standing in the way of this warm embrace.
Mm-hmm.
Muslims have to drop the parts of their ideology that contradict modern thought.
The bad news is then we'll find somebody else to hate.
We could totally accelerate that process.
Should we just, let's go right now to someone.
May I? F*** Dutch.
Yeah.
Well.
Always great to see you. Always a wonderful discussion.
I don't agree.
No.
I didn't find it a wonderful discussion.
No. Jon Stewart's ambivalence towards Hishi Ali was better suited, directed at Reza Aslan.
I think he got played a bit. I can't put my finger up on it. Maybe the stupid way he came onto the set, the enthusiasm, the jokes. I think Jon Stewart had a longing for a comfortable discussion on this very uncomfortable reality, and Reza Aslan delivers always.
That's Reza Aslan's job, I think, making this very uncomfortable subject sound comfortable.
I think it's telling about religion that the stricter you follow the fundamentals, the more of a dick you're perceived yeah. to be.
Die mensen, die stammen die eerst een meisje van de rots hebben geduwd. Ja, ja. En die storten naar beneden en die spatten uit elkaar. Dat is iemands dochter.
Ja, en dan leg je de verantwoordelijkheid bij de burgers, bij de meerderjarige burgers.
Ja.
En als die willen dat jongeren gaan drinken, dan gaan de jongeren drinken.